Hi.
Hello.
So when adapting the series from the books, how closely were you aiming to make it like the books? Because I think the example that a lot of people have been comparing to, it really ended up taking its own direction.
Right.
A lot of things. Some people love it, some people hate it, but each their own.
I mean.
So, you know, I'm just curious what was your approach in adapting the material.
Well, one of the things when looking at the material that was super important to me was the characters. I love these characters. I fell in love with the characters. I fell in love with their relationships. I fell in love with their love stories. And so that was super important. As well as we took parts of the first book and the third book for the massive plot of the first season. In terms of the individual stories, Midnight Texas, one of the beautiful things about it is it's a tiny little town. And so it moves at a tiny town pace. And when we adapted it for NBC, they're like, well, can we add the little, you know, incident? And, you know, honestly, if I couldn't add incidents of vampires and were-tigers and angels, you know, given my writer's go-kart. So it was about adding more than subtracting.
Yeah.
It was about keeping true the heart and the spirit of Midnight and its characters, but adding more plot,
yeah.
Incident.
We both fell in love with the books immediately, so we came at it from a place of, you know, fondness and admiration.
Yes, and wanting to be true to that.
Exactly. So you'll see throughout the course of the first 10 episodes, there's so many things that are pulled from all three of the books, and there's still a lot more left for a second season and a third season and a fourth season. But like in any adaptation, you know, a writer needs to run with it and turn it into a living three-dimensional show. So a lot of it is also invented by Monica.
How did you on this series figure out that this is the one that you wanted to tackle?
I read the books first with my executives at my company. We fell in love with it. We shared it with Monica. We had never met. We had never worked together. And she shared the exact same passion that we had for the world and the characters in the world. And the rest is history. We brought it to NBC. They fell in love with it as well. Totally allowed us to make the show that we wanted to make. Charlaine was supportive and involved and passionate about her work as well, and passionate about what we were doing in turning it into a show. So it really kind of was a love fest all around.
No, and it was nice because I was working on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which I love and was a wonderful show, but I had had these tragedies in my life, and I was like, I'm looking for something to write to like get my mind off of stuff. And because my mom-in-law and my mom had died, and I get these books, and my mom lived in a tiny little town with one stoplight, and my mother-in-law was a psychic. And I was like, I read two chapters, I'm like, okay, this is a friggin' sign, because I love these characters and this is too on point. So so for me, it was just a love fest, and honestly, the heart of the show, the theme of the show, that a group of very diverse people who have different talents, who bring different things to bear, who are really different from each other, but can come together to form a community that has each other's back in the face of adversaries, that to me felt so like perfect and beautiful and representative of what I want to see on television. So I had also had this lovely theme in the middle of it from which to spin out all these crazy supernatural stories, because what I loved about it was this town of people who are so different from one another who really come together and create a community that's stronger together than apart.
The tagline, "Only Outsiders Fit In," really resonated with us when the marketing team came up with that, and we kind of feel like Midnighters ourselves.
Yeah, exactly.
In the real world.
So how timely is a show like this with what's going on in the world right now? And the fact that in the books, the first book has this white supremacist in it and everything. Like, perfect.
It was weird because we were shooting this white supremacist episode, and I was just like, I thought it would be like a cool pulpy moment, not timely. But so I did not expect to be timely. timely.
Relevant.
But at the same time, look, it's a message I live by. It's a truth that I live by. I have an interracial family. I live in a diverse city that I'm super proud of. This cast is a diverse cast of people who bring, their diversity makes them stronger together. And so for me, this is an ideal way to like write a crazy supernatural show, which is also with this heart that I can believe in and value and happy to put out in the world. Yes, we have villains that come in, many of which are new, and they come to serve other characters. We learn a lot about Manfred from one villain who comes in. So yes, we sort of use our villains to also fill in our character stories, and you know, hopefully we'll get a season 2 because there's some characters from the book that I really want to bring in.
and Monica really dives deep in each episode into one Midnighter character, and a lot of the backstories and what they're made up of are invented by Monica as well. It's kind of a perfect blend of what Charlaine set forth in her books and Monica kind of took over the finish line.
Are you
reading
an Adventure Time
shirt? I am! I just got my clothes! I know my son bought it for me because I couldn't go to the floor and I was like, so yes.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.